Let's say we have a corporation and it can issue shares at $10 per share, and the bonds, if they issue them, would be 5%. And we're going to have the total of the capital structure, the stock and the bonds, always add to 2,000. So if we had no bonds, all stock, $10 a share, 2,000, we'd have 200 shares. And we're going to do two scenarios of looking at incomes of, say, 120 and 80. Well, with no interest charges, the incomes would remain unchanged, and the earnings per share would be respectively 60 cents in the 120 case and 40 cents in the 80 case. Now, let's say they sell some bonds and thus have fewer shares. And let's say now we have 180 shares, $10 a share, 180 shares, and we have 200 in bonds paying 5%, the interest charge would be 10 bucks. And we'll subtract that from the revenues, giving now respectively net incomes of 110 and 70. And now the earnings per share in the 120 case rise to 61 cents, and in the 80 revenue case, now meaning net income of 70 after the interest charge, is now 39 cents. And we do this again, and again, and again. And finally, we come down to the case of where we have $400, that's 40 shares, and we now have $1,600 in bonds paying 5%, that's an $80 interest charge. And now look, the earnings per share are a dollar in the good case and zero in the bad case. And we could, of course, do a more sensitive analysis of other earnings coming in. Instead of just the 120 and the 80, let's step it by 10, going from 120 all the way down to 70. And here's the spreadsheet. Our numbers match as before. And, let's look at a graph. And here it is. And sure enough, in good times, by borrowing money, we make even more and more and more per earnings per share. And in bad times, it gets worse and worse and worse until we actually start losing money. And interestingly, at the case of us making 100, which let's say if we made 5%, and we are borrowing at 5%, it should be a wash. And it turns out it is. There's no effect. And the idea here is that one does want to borrow money if one makes a high rate of return. Of course, you regret it if you're wrong. And of course, I've oversimplified things. First of all, with the assumption that the share price and the interest rate on the bonds would remain constant. Counterintuitively, as one borrows, not only does the interest rate go up, but also the cost of equity capital, the share price, would also be affected. And one could look at something called the weighted average cost of capital. Well, it's the average, we use K here, and it's the weight in debt times the cost of debt plus the weight in equity times the cost of equity. And if those are the only two things in the capital structure, one can say, well, gee, the weight in debt subtracted from 1 should be the weight in equity. The cost of the debt should be the interest rate after tax. And from the stock valuation model, one can say, well, it could be the dividends over the price plus the growth rate. And indeed, if one did have preferred shares, it would appear as the second of these three terms now. And no longer would the weight in equity be 1 minus the weight in debt, and the cost of the preferred would be just dividends over the price of preferred. But let's say we just kept the two extreme cases of just debt and common shares. Well, it turns out that one can adjust the risk of the firm measured in something called beta. and you can have the beta of the firm, maybe unlevered. And it turns out there's an equation for you. I'm not going to hold you to it, but it turns out it's 1 plus 1 minus the tax rate times the debt equity ratio. And if one makes some substitutions and brings that back in, replacing the cost of equity now with the capital asset pricing model, I know this is advanced stuff, we can see what's there on line 5A. I rearranged the terms so you can notice kind of a parallel structure that you have the weight in debt times the cost of interest after tax, and you'll see that kind of the same term reappear inside the computation for the unlevered beta, substituting in for the capital asset pricing model. Now remember, of course, these have overly simplified assumptions. And indeed, the cost of equity and debt both rise because the firm is riskier when you do borrow monies. And what's kind of counterintuitive, that even though they both rise, you can actually lower the weighted average cost of capital when you combine the two in some optimal ratio. And this particular example, it's around 50-50. Of course, that's not always the case, and most books leave out the counterexample. It may go the other way. This example is sometimes found in the utilities industry. Something to think about with Dr. C Invests.